Hi, friends and people of goodwill. We start today with a quote from the book called Gifts of Heaven by Jakob Lorber, belonging to the so-called New Revelation. This is a huge body of texts comprising 10,000 pages and dozens of books written by Jakob Lorber and Gottfried Mayerhofer between 1840 and 1877 with a declared author, the Lord Jesus Christ himself. The two writers also confess to have received these texts by prophetic dictation, and it is certified that they had no material gain whatsoever from this endeavor. What I found in these books, and especially in the main monumental work called the Great Gospel of John, which comprises 7,000 pages, is the following. First, the most complex and detailed description of Jesus Christ's life and teaching in full agreement with the Christian scriptures. I also found confirmations and explanations of many fundamental facts pertaining to the Old and the New Testament with clear revelation of their spiritual meanings. I found a detailed description of God as a Trinity, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, as also his spiritual and material creation. I found a clear revelation of his extraordinary plan of salvation. I found the most impressive portrait of a God of infinite love, wisdom, forgiveness, compassion, and self-sacrifice as incarnated in Jesus for the sake of humanity and all his creation. I found detailed revelations concerning life after death, heaven and hell, the eternal destiny of man, all this in agreement with the Christian scriptures, but also with reliable near-death experiences and paranormal research. I found compelling answers to the most important issues ever raised against the Christian doctrine. And finally, I found an unmatched presentation of the human being from both a natural and a spiritual perspective, a clear statement of the purpose of life and creation, which in essence is nothing else but an increasingly loving relationship with the Creator. I found spiritual explanations of great socio-political and psychological questions and numerous historical, geographical, social, and anthropological facts from the times and places mentioned in the Bible. I found a great amount of fundamental facts about nature, biology, geology, chemistry, astronomy, etc., with explanations of their spiritual causes. Some of these facts have been confirmed later on by science, while others have not yet been studied. Most stunningly, I found accurate social and technological predictions concerning the time we are living in, or the end time preceding Lord's second coming, which is predicted in these teachings to be in less than 2,000 years since the Lord died on the cross. And now, in the book called Divine Gifts, which is full of extraordinary biblical explanations, we also find the paragraph quoted in the beginning, and I'll read it again. They killed the prophets and left their dead bodies lying in the street for 3.5 days. This signifies when mankind heard the teachings of my chosen ones, they refused to accept them, mocked my scribes and servants, or regarded them as non-existent, as dead. They rejected my teachings or left them lying on the open street, not believing in them, but also not completely discarding them either. And now, let's say something about the manuscripts of these texts that present themselves as dictated by Jesus Christ himself. They do still exist today, most of them in Germany, at the Lorber Verlag publishing house in Bietigheim, where they can be consulted. Some pictures of them leaked out on the internet in the last 20 years, testifying of the fluent, non-interrupted writing with no corrections at all. In the case of Lorber, one may add to this unusual fact the written testimonies of friends and credible local authorities attesting that the writing proceeded uninterruptedly as if under an unheard dictation. Considering also the stunning intellectual expression and the great amount of information that was unreachable, not only for the writers, but for any human being at the time, I think that any honest researcher may find enough in them to justify this hypothesis of prophetic inner dictation. However, despite the huge challenges that these unique teachings present to any Christian as possibly genuine messages of Jesus Christ, there is no acknowledged theological work dealing with them at all. No lectures, no conferences, no official studies or debates anywhere in the world. And this for more than 150 years. So, are these two writers not left as dead, as non-existent, by all the learned people of the world, be they in the realm of religion or science? Anybody can see that a book like Neil Walsh's Conversations with God, that doesn't present anything that a human mind cannot immediately conceive and has no scientific, theological, or biblical relevance, got a thousandfold better distribution and promotion than any of the books of the New Revelation. Not to mention the universally promoted Harry Potter fantasy books, which popularized witchcraft, that got turned into huge movies and even got studied into many Western schools. Let's compare such bestsellers with a 7,000-page Great Gospel of John, containing everything you can find in the Gospels and explaining them like nothing else in the world, and adding to that countless relevant scientific, theological, and spiritual facts. Well, this monumental religious book is not even today completely published on paper in English and in most international languages. Only due to the dedicated work of a couple of volunteering translators, it can be found now for free on the internet. But why this utter neglect of a work that in matters of faith can change the entire course of humanity? For this, we may need to look at what happened when the Lord Himself came on this earth as Messiah, the teacher of His people, who were supposed to be the faithful keepers of the previous word of God. Was He confirming the old scriptures of the Jews, and was He fulfilling their prophecies? The Gospels show that He was. But did the religious authorities of the time acknowledge that? No, all Christians know that He was dismissed as a deceiver and finally put on the cross for His claims that He, as the Son of God, is giving people a true divine teaching. Today, the new people of God and their teacher, I mean the Christians and their pastors or priests, or as said in the Great Gospel of John, the new Jews and the new Pharisees, are also challenged by this teaching that confirms their own scriptures and unveils their mysteries, same as the Lord did 2,000 years ago. Moreover, with some small efforts, they can observe that such a new word of God was also predicted in the biblical prophecy concerning the second coming, as I have discovered myself quite easily. Now, one may wonder if any of the Christians I personally met really care enough about such arguments, so to read a bit of the New Revelation. Well, majority didn't bother to read at all, or they did read something, but only with the clear intention to dismiss it. The most probable cause I found for this is the Lutheran dogma of sola scriptura, or only the Bible, which made its way throughout generations of Protestant Christians. But this is contradicted by the Bible itself. For how could it be biblical to despise prophecies, to quench the Spirit, and stop testing the spirits to see if they come from God or not? These are Apostle Paul's words. The New Testament speaks clearly about prophets and the gift of prophecy in the first Christian churches. The arguments that such sola scriptura Christians are bringing against any new messages from God are extremely superficial. First, they used to quote Timothy, who says that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. By this, they understand that their Bible, the Scripture, is all they need to be perfect, or to become perfect. However, Timothy wasn't speaking about the Bible, for the simple reason that this wasn't compiled at the time. He surely wasn't speaking just about the Old Testament either, because some of the Gospels and letters of the Apostles were already in circulation. By all Scripture, he surely meant all messages from God which were written down for the benefit of the people. The other most common argument used by Protestant Christians to reject anything outside of the Bible is the warning of John from the end of his revelation, which indeed is the end of the Bible also. And he says, "For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of this prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book." That's Revelation 22. Obviously, this book was a book like all the prophetic books of the Old Testament, the book, or rather the scroll, that John was just finishing writing. In no way that could have been the not yet compiled Bible. Now, besides this, only the Bible Christians that unwillingly deny a living and speaking God, I have also met some other Christians who do accept the possibility of newer communications from God, but they still would not read the new revelation because it doesn't have the express recommendation of any pastoral authority. They need a special man's voice to guarantee for the truth coming from God, probably because they don't dare to trust their own hearts, minds, and conscience enough to give them a proper answer. And surely they don't dare to stand up against what they accepted for so long as their proper religious authorities. But what was the reply of the Christian pastors that I've met to the new revelation? You think they may have been impressed by the fact that the new revelation is in perfect agreement with the Bible, and considering the number of pages, it may bring up many other important things? You think they may have considered that God could wish to finally strengthen this weak and fragmented Christianity by answering to many fundamental questions and matters of dispute between various Christian churches? You think they may have been touched by it because of the biblical prophecy that at the second coming there will be just one church and one shepherd, thus no division in the interpretation and practice of God's true religion? Well, I for one thought so in my utter naivety. However, the shepherds I encountered by now were not at all interested in the possibility of having the Lord himself as their teacher in matters pertaining to the Bible. I think this happened because, same as their lambs, the shepherds either just stick to the Bible, or they don't, but they do prefer to pick up the prophecies that are most convenient to them. A prophecy spread on 10,000 pages with no official endorsement from any recognized authority, a prophecy that is so revolutionary that would point to the near end of all institutionalized Christianity and thus a very possible termination of their ministry, that is definitely not convenient. As it wasn't convenient for the Pharisees either 2,000 years ago when they heard such things straight from the mouth of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. However, if some of the dear friends in Christ would find in their hearts enough goodwill to give God a chance with this teaching, they may discover not only that the new revelation speaks about the Bible, not only that it explains the known Gospels and the prophetic language of both the Old and the New Testament, but also, what I said before, that the Bible itself speaks about the new revelation, predicting its arrival in the world before the second coming. For wherever you find in the Old Testament or in the Revelation of John the words water of life or rain from heaven or fountain of pure water, or the great feast, it is all about the Word of God. The Lord says in the New Revelation, I am speaking according to my faith, of course. So the Lord says, so consider my word a rain from the heavens of all life, and the life-giving property of the water of this my living word will no longer be a riddle to you. Now, when we get biblical prophecies clearly pointing to the second coming, I mean when the Lord is becoming the ruler of all nations, we see that an increasing knowledge and disclosure of the mysteries of God are promised. We also see that the Lord speaks or shouts from heaven, and that he has got a strong argument with the shepherds that do not lead the people properly. Whoever wants to read more about this, I'll put a link to the study below. This study concerns the link between the Bible and the New Revelation and the matter of the two witnesses from the Revelation of John. Please, however, consider that with this study, I have just scratched the surface of something really huge that can for sure be investigated and presented much, much better by people more knowledgeable than me. The arguments that the New Revelation is the predicted outpouring of divine knowledge before the second coming, and thus that the two joint witnesses or prophets of Revelation 11 are indeed Jakob Lorber and Gottfried Mayerhofer, the scribes of the New Revelation, in my opinion, these arguments are overwhelming. What is needed to proceed to such research, however, is the goodwill of a loving heart, for beyond any theological investigation, it is the heart or the spirit of God in man that truly recognizes this God who is love in his word of love. My sheep, listen to my voice, says the Lord. And now, for the ones who, in their blindness, don't see any relevance of a message from God today, I will expose here what I have discovered to be the core of the Lord's teaching in the New Revelation. And this is the following. We are spiritual, eternal beings created out of love by a God who is infinite love, in order to be in a forever, increasingly loving relationship with him, our fellow man, and the entire creation. He made us in his image in order to become his loving children, with whom he would share all his wisdom, all his powers, and creations forever. However, things are not straight ahead so simple and wonderful for us, because, like our Father himself, we are also endowed with a perfect free will. This we can utterly misuse and thus find ourselves in opposition with the divine order, a possibility which has been very much facilitated for us by the fall, the spiritual fall of the first created being, Lucifer, and by the spiritual fall of the parents of our species, Adam and Eve. Thus, by indulging in selfishness, in greed, pride, and all evil feelings and deeds, we can also spiritually fall, and thus ensure for us a very miserable and scary life for a very long time on the other side. And that's because on the other side, in the spiritual world, everything we deal with around us depends on what is inside us, what is in our hearts and our souls. The model of the perfect man that we need to follow was indeed given to us in Jesus, who is God himself, who incarnated on earth, who taught, healed, performed miracles, and even died for us in order to save us from the power that the fallen Lucifer had upon our souls, a power that would otherwise ensure our indefinite persistence in the anti-order, or in other words, an eternally very dark and limited existence on the other side. Here on earth, in this physical garment of our true soul being, we are in a great trial life, a trial of our free will, on which our entire existence as spiritual beings depends upon. whatever evil comes upon us and our dear ones in this life is never, ever God's revenge, but always the consequence of the misuse of our individual free will. For being perfectly free in our heart's choices, we do carry an individual and a collective responsibility for everything we think and we do. Now listen to the Lord speaking in the New Revelation about this. I have often shown you the endless necessity of the free will of man and explained to you how the eternal life of the spirit in man depends entirely on it, and that in order to preserve it, I would rather die myself than even touch a little this free will with my omnipotence. For the most subtle touch of the freedom of human will by my will would instantly cost every human being their lives. Well, if beyond the natural order of things, we, the created ones, dare to expect a special protection or grace from this God of all love and mercy, then obviously we should turn away from our anti-order, from our wicked, selfish ways, and really start abiding in this order of true, altruistic love that God Himself in Jesus taught us in the New Testament and in the New Revelation. Whoever can face the struggles and evils of this early earthly life, and also the painful separation from the body, without giving a chance to this most loving God, Father, to help and protect him for his own sake, is free indeed to have it his way. He can truly be his own God if he so wishes. But it is written, the truth that is sustaining the entire creation to the very last atom, his own life included, will one day be, in his own heart, his most severe judge. It is also written that a great prophecy is also a great judgment for the people. Those who do not receive it are obviously judged, meaning bound to their sins and thus lacking in the true love, which is also the only true eternal existence. Many people, be they Christians or not, have today a feeling of the severity of the global situation of humanity. And that is what you can find out in the New Revelation. Since selfishness, as opposite to my love, and love as such, has become the main hobby of today's mankind, and since, as a result of this foolish behavior, my patience is beginning to run out, this word, the New Revelation, is being given to you again, so that before the general decline, many may still be saved from completely losing their human dignity, their sole share in the spiritual world. And also, lest all men be lost, I have ordained, and this is required for my second coming, that from now on, my word and teaching shall be given to a few in an unadulterated form, as I once gave it to my disciples, not veiled as in the prophets, but as clear and comprehensible as my disciples once taught it to the people. I, for one, think it is high time for humanity to know about this great word of God, which can and will, as predicted, one day soon change everything for the better on this earth. For if people want such change, they surely need a good example. And what better one can there be than that of a most loving Godfather who did his utmost, culminating in enduring torture and death on the cross in order to bring the eternal life of love to all his children and through them to his entire creation. This is a divine Father Creator who only asks for the people to listen to their conscience, to do good to each other, and to love the greatest love who once died for them as a man himself. please listen to his voice. Do good to everyone. No one is too small for you, no one too great. For in the kingdom of God prevails the fullest equality of all estates, of all nations. Only in the dress of poverty the Lord often comes to his children on the earth, but they do not recognize him, because their concepts of God in and out of themselves already are pride. And adding to that, you demand of me unlimited grace, and I demand of you unlimited love. With this exchange, it is only you who gain, since I want to accord you a might that shall make you lords of all that was created. Thank you very much for taking the time to listen to this presentation. If allowed, I will speak again about the prophecies of the end time that are already getting fulfilled before our own very eyes. Let all the people of goodwill be blessed and know the wonderful grace and mercy of God. And let all praise and glory of love be His forever. Amen.